So God spoke to Jeremiah one day, and he said, go down to the potter's house, and I'm going to talk to you there. So Jeremiah said, so I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he brought a work on the wheel. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the potter's hands. And you know, sometimes that's how our lives feel. Something comes along in life and just totally messes up our life. I love the story of the potter and the clay because he didn't stop there. As Jeremiah was watching the potter, so he made it again. I seemed good to the potter to make it. And then God began to speak to Jeremiah. And he said, cannot I do this with you? For as clay is in the potter's hands, so are you in my hands, O house of Israel. God was speaking to an entire nation at that time, how they had wandered away and turned to idols, and their world was falling apart. Yet God was saying to them, if you just turn over yourself to me, I can remake you again, just like the potter. He was saying that to a whole nation. How much more could he say that to us as individuals? So let me ask you, could this clay ever fix itself? So why is it that we think that we can fix ourselves, or that we have to fix ourselves or make things right before we come back to God? When in reality, we never really can fix ourselves, not really. And all God wants us to do is just turn the mess over to Him. And just turn it over to Him, and so that He can put things back together. Because see, He's the potter. He's really good at that.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to worship at Scarborough Salvation Army. My name is Luke Furlong, and it is a privilege for me to be able to greet you in the name of the Lord this morning. As we begin our time of worship together, I want to start with a call to worship from Psalm 100, and I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him singing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving. Go into His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever, and His faithfulness continues to each generation. Amen. Our opening song this morning is inspired by these words from Psalm 100. I will enter His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. Now, wherever you are watching this morning, I invite you to lift your voice in praise to God as we sing this song. Thank you. For our prayer time this morning, we're going to be doing something a little bit different. And so, wherever you're watching this morning, I invite you just to sit back and watch the screen as Sam Barker transforms Play-Doh, simple Play-Doh, into a masterpiece.
A lump of Play-Doh. Without form and shape, it doesn't look like anything special. After all, it's just a lump of Play-Doh. But in the hands of a skilled craftsman, what seems to be something ordinary can be transformed into something extraordinary. A masterpiece. In the same way, we are like a ball of Play-Doh. We may not think of ourselves as being anything special. We may look at ourselves and believe that we are nothing special. But in the eyes of the divine craftsman, our loving heavenly Father, he sees what we cannot see. He sees our potential, and by his grace and power, our lives can be transformed into something more beautiful than we could ever imagine. You are God's masterpiece.
One of the favourite elements of my current ministry as a community mission facilitator for the Salvation Army has to be its diversity. No day is ever the same. And no day is ever boring. And when you're helping out with toddlers, no day is ever boring. From week to week, I never know what mood the little ones will be in and what they'll want to play with when they come through our doors. Now, on one occasion, it was decided that on the messy table, we would get out the enemy of hall cleaners everywhere, the Play-Doh. As I sat on the little toddler chairs, looking rather silly, I watched as clumps of Play-Doh were transformed into what I can only describe as pieces of abstract artwork, before they were swiftly squashed into a ball and made into something new. Now, whilst I didn't always understand what had been created, each child knew what it was they wanted to make from the Play-Doh. They had their own master plan, and they didn't give up when the Play-Doh had other ideas. Unable just to sit and watch, I too began to shape the Play-Doh, and that's when the seed was planted. Whilst the story of Jeremiah's visit to the potter's house may be a familiar one to some of us, its message remains one of great challenge, and the lessons we can learn from it are what I feel God has led me to share with you today. Now, before we look at the lessons from the potter's house, I invite you to sing again as we sing Lord of Creation. Our Bible reading for this morning is taken from Jeremiah 18, verses 1 through to 6. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Go down to the potter's house, and there I will give you my message. So I went down to the potter's house and saw him working at the wheel. But the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands. So the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. He said, Can I not do with you, Israel, as this potter does, declares the Lord. Like clay in the hand of the potter, so are you in my hand, Israel. Whilst the potter's workshop may not be a common sight on today's high street, a potter at work on their wheel was a far more familiar sight in the Old Testament towns and villages at the time of Jeremiah. At the beginning of the passage, God commands his prophet to go to the potter's house so that he can receive a message. As already mentioned, the sight of a potter at his wheel would have been a common occurrence for Jeremiah. God used the potter's house to help his prophet understand his mind, the divine potter at work with his human clay. In the business of life, how often do we miss God in the everyday? Perhaps we may even take God's presence in the everyday for granted. God didn't allow the everyday sight of a potter at his wheel to pass Jeremiah by. He used the day-to-day as a teaching opportunity. Think about where you will be this time tomorrow, or where you would normally be this time tomorrow. Wherever you find yourself, don't let the everyday idly pass you by. Instead, keep an open mind and an open heart to what God might want to say to you. Upon entering the potter's house, Jeremiah witnesses the potter at work. Whenever the pot the potter was working on turned out badly, as sometimes happens when you're working with clay, the potter would simply start over and use the same clay to make another pot. In the art of pottery, there are a number of factors that may cause the clay to become marred. Perhaps there was a degree of carelessness on the part of the potter, or maybe the machinery they are using is faulty. It may even be a flaw in the clay itself. However, the central truth of this verse is not the marring of the pot. Rather, it is that the potter persevered. He didn't give up on the clay and was able to mould it into another vessel. In the same way that the earthly potter had his clay, we are the clay in the hands of a divine potter. Now try as we might to shape ourselves, believing that we know best, things will inevitably go wrong, and what we have tried to shape ourselves into will become marred and full of flaws, and we're back to square one. And we try yet again to shape ourselves, with the end result being the exact same. There is only one divine potter, friends, and I'm sorry to say it isn't you and it isn't I. It is our Heavenly Father, the Master Craftsman. When a potter goes in search for the clay he is going to use to make his vessel, he wouldn't be looking for the perfect, pristine lump of clay. Why? Because the potter knows that there is no such thing as perfect clay. The clay is going to have muck, mire, and junk inside of it. The potter knows that removing these imperfections is all part of the formation process. God uses us as we are, imperfections and all. God doesn't cast us out as a bad lot because of our imperfections. He reshapes, refines, and cleanses. transforming us into something more beautiful than we could ever hope to shape ourselves. If you're reading this passage and happen to be in any doubt as to how you are like the clay, then verse 6 removes all doubt. After witnessing the potter transform a lump of clay into a pot, God gives Jeremiah a message to share with the people of Israel. Can't I do just as this potter does, people of Israel? Watch this potter. In the same way that this potter works on his clay, I work on you. The message here is one of God's divine sovereignty. The question does not ask for permission, but declares the truth that God is the all-powerful creator. When God gave this message to Jeremiah, the people of Israel, God's chosen people, were getting things very wrong. God declares his rightful sovereignty over his people in verse 8, but promises that those who turn back to him, he will start over with. Just as the potter started over when the pot he was working at became misshaped. Whilst we may not go as far as the people of Israel did in committing acts of social injustice, forgetting our covenant to God, and generally going down the wrong track, each of us, if we are truly honest, will say there have been times when we've fallen short and got things wrong when we've tried to do things in our own way. I know I certainly have. Maybe some of you will be able to resonate with a very one-way conversation that I've had with God. Look, I'm too far gone. I've messed up yet again. So why on earth would you want to use me for your purpose? It's really quite simple. Each and every one of us is in the hands of a master potter. Our gracious and loving God, a potter who doesn't give up on us. He takes us as we are and shapes us for his purpose. There is a great comfort to be taken from the knowledge that we are in the hands of such a loving creator and that he knows what's best for us as his clay. There are many great songs that talk about God as the potter and we his clay. And one such song that we're going to share just now is song number 409 in the Salvation Army songbook. Words that I wasn't really familiar with until quite recently. And the words are as follows. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mould me and make me. This is what I pray. Let's share in this song together just now.
Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. Change my heart, oh God,
come change my heart.
As we saw earlier on in our prayer time, there is a great art and process when it comes to creating a masterpiece out of Play-Doh. And in the same way, a potter has a process that they would follow to create their masterpiece. The first step in this process is called balancing the clay. The potter must ensure that the clay they're working on is centered properly on the wheel. If not centered properly, the clay will collapse. As the potter seeks to center the clay will fight back. Just like the potter with his clay, God is seeking to center us. Do we, like the clay, wrestle him for control as he seeks to bring our lives into a place of balance? We can be at rest with God if we stop the struggle, stop the fighting, and allow him to shape us according to his purpose. Once the clay has been centered on the wheel, the potter makes an indentation with his fingers so that a vessel can be created. The aim of the potter is to move the clay rather than dig it out from the vessel. In the same way, God uses us as we are, warts and all, using our experiences for his glory. In every stage of the process, the potter's hands remain on the clay, and we, like clay, are kept safe in the loving arms of God. As the clay spins on the wheel, the potter cleans out the interior of the vessel he is making. If we are to be truly God's vessels, are we willing to let God refine and clean us? Becoming less of self and more of him is hard work. The world teaches us that we should be living life for ourselves, and the only person that matters in the world is us. Francis Chan calls this life in selfie mode, where our sole focus in life is on me, myself, and I. If we turn off selfie mode and look up towards someone who is so much more beautiful than us, our lives will be transformed. As the clay is lifted up, what started out as a formless and shapeless lump of clay now begins to reflect the design intended for it by the potter. I encourage you to release yourselves for God's purpose. When we let God lift us up, the change can begin in our hearts, and then our outward appearance will begin to reflect God's inner shaping. In his letter to the church at Corinth, Paul has these words from 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18. He shapes each part of our lives for his wider purpose, and so we are transfigured, much like the Messiah, our lives gradually becoming brighter and more beautiful, as God enters our lives and we become like him. In the closing moments of our time together, I encourage you, if you felt God speaking to you, to not let this moment pass you by. If you feel like you've been wrestling with God, stop the struggle, and find rest in the loving arms of God. It's a lot easier that way. I am a firm believer that we are all called to be part of God's mission. No one is too far gone to be used by God. If we are to be truly God's vessels, are we willing to let God shape us to his purpose? Will you allow him to take you, mould you, use you, and fill you? This transformation doesn't have to wait till this time tomorrow, or till next Sunday, or till the point when we can go back to our places of worship. This transformation can happen now, and the change can begin today. All you have to do is say yes. In the closing moments of our time together, I encourage you to spend some time in prayer with God and ask him if there are any areas that he needs to illuminate for you that you need to surrender over to him.
I cry, oh Lord, please take my hand. You call me to your perfect plan. Beautiful Lord, wonderful Saviour, I know for sure all of my days are held in your hand, crafted into your perfect plan. You gently call me into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord, to live all of my life through your eyes. I'm captured by your holy calling. Set me apart. I know your draw. Sweet.
Dear Lord, as we have thought about what it means to be the clay in your hands, I pray that we will be responsive to your calling upon our lives, and we will allow you to shape us for your purpose. Forgive us, Lord, for the times when we have tried to do things in our own strength and shape ourselves in our own image. Help us to surrender our lives to you, the Master Potter, so that through us you will be glorified and other people shall come to know you as their own personal saviour and loving friend. Amen. As our time of worship comes to a close just now, we're going to finish by singing some great words of the church. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can keep me always clean? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Please lift your voices as we sing to conclude. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And finally, a benediction to close with. Go with confidence into the days ahead, trusting in God's unfailing love and faithfulness. God will not abandon you, for you are the work of his hands, his own creation, and his love endures forever. So go, enjoy, to love and serve the Lord. Amen. God bless you.
We are the clay. You are the potter. We are all works in your hands. You have a plan for our lives. A purpose. A future. You promise you won't leave us. And when we face the tests and trials, you are there. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future.